welcome to tonight's event, the third lecture of the Ayn Rand Institute's 2005 lecture series. My name is Yaron Brook, and I'm the executive director of the Ayn Rand Institute, which is headquartered here in Irvine, California. Now, the Ayn Rand Institute is a non-for-profit, and all our programs are funded by individuals like you, private contributions. And if you would like to see talks like this continue, I encourage you to contribute to the Institute. If you want to specifically support this series, please let us know that is what you would like. So see me at the end or Mark Chapman at the back if you're interested in supporting the continuation of these lectures. A few brief announcements before we begin tonight. As you've probably seen, we have a bookstore in the back of the room with a selection of Ayn Rand's fiction and nonfiction writings and other books and recordings specifically on foreign policy and terrorism that are related to tonight's talk. Also, I'd like to announce that the next lecture of this year's series is now scheduled for Tuesday, May 24th. The lecture will be presented by Dr. Gary Hall, and it is entitled Antitrust is Immoral. Our speaker tonight is Dr. John Lewis, Assistant Professor of History at Ashland University in Ashland, Ohio. Dr. Lewis holds a PhD in Classics from the University of Cambridge and a BA in History from the University of Rhode Island. He taught ancient history at the University of London and was a visiting scholar at Rice University and Bowling Green State University. Dr. Lewis has published in classical journals such as Polis, DK, I can't pronounce these, Bryn Mawr, Classical Review, is that right? And Anglo-Hellenic Review, and in Capitalism magazine. His book, Solon the Thinker, A Political Thought in Ancient Athens, is forthcoming from Duckworth Press. Tonight's lecture is entitled The Failure of Homeland Defense, The Lessons from History. At the end of the lecture, I'll be joining Dr. Lewis to take questions from the audience. So if you have questions at that time, please come up to the mic here in the center aisle. And now join me in welcoming Dr. John Lewis.
Thank you very much, Dr. Brook. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bush administration, we hear daily, is waging an all-out, quote, war, unquote, with enemies who have killed thousands of Americans. But I maintain, this description of the Bush administration's actions is not accurate. This is a war in name only, in which we have failed to pursue the destruction of the governments involved in these attacks, have substituted a, quote, war on terror, unquote, for a war against militant Islamic totalitarian fundamentalists, and have actually denied the religious fundamentalist goals that our enemy has openly stated. This is like a World War II against dictatorship that refuses to fight Nazi Germany. Now, not all is without hope here. President Bush has lifted many restrictions from our covert forces, and many of our enemies are, in his good words, quote, no longer a problem, unquote. However, with two exceptions, we have exempted all of the governments who have supported this war from the consequences of their actions. Afghanistan, the first of these exceptions, was little more than a place for our enemies to hide. By attacking this refuge, we scattered the fundamentalists across the Middle East and allowed them to create a myth of surviving an all-out assault by America. This they claim as their second victory, the first being the defeat of the Russians in 1989, which they claim is a victory. As of this day, the Taliban in Afghanistan are preparing for a new assault in the spring. Now, Iraq, the second exception, was attacked for inconsistent reasons and only after months of begging the UN for permission. Now we are engaged in a great project to bring water, food, clothing, democracy, and social mobility to the Iraqis at the cost of a slow bleed of over 1,500 American lives still counting. We are prosecuting our own troops while taking great pains not to subject enemy prisoners to the slightest discomfort. This, we are told, is how we can win the war. Now, meanwhile, North Korea and Iran are building nuclear weapons, the latter with Russian aid. President Bush, in response, says that North Korea can be restrained by diplomatic talks, that European diplomacy and American aid can keep Iran from developing such weapons, and that Russia is our friend and ally in the war. Well, the fact is, we Americans have not asserted our non-negotiable sovereign right to defend ourselves. We have not shown America's enemies the consequences of advocating war against us. We have not established a causal connection between taking up arms against America and personal destruction. Our enemies have taken this as weakness, as bin Laden wrote explicitly in his declaration of war against us. He may not be wrong. However, this does not mean that we have been inactive. We are working night and day and have committed billions of dollars to a so-called homeland defense, a defensive, institutionalized, permanent state of siege at home. This is defensive because it is focused on preventing attacks rather than eliminating their source. It is institutionalized, given its cabinet-level status. It is permanent in that no conditions have been established for its end. It is not meant to deal with an emergency, but with a permanency. We have hired over 50,000 guards to man our airports alone. From now on, military jets circling New York City, anti-aircraft batteries around Washington, and soldiers at the Super Bowl are to be facts of life in America. From now on, Americans are to be reminded daily, on television, at the train station, at their place of employment, in the college classroom, that they are vulnerable, and that this vulnerability is permanent. This is unprecedented in our history. But it may not be unprecedented in human history. So let us ask tonight, what historical precedents have existed for such a posture by a nation with overwhelming military superiority? When in history have countries capable of offensive action refused to take such action? And what were the consequences? What lessons do they have for us? And here I will cut to the chase. In every case I've investigated, a nation that has adopted a primarily defensive posture has not succeeded as long as its posture has remained defensive. To the extent that it followed such a strategy, that nation could at best postpone or stalemate a war. If it remained in that defensive position too long, it was destroyed. In every case I've examined, the party under attack has failed to the extent that it did not project its power outside its own borders, with certainty, clarity, and overwhelming force to the center of the enemy's power. It is never enough simply to push an aggressive enemy off your own land and then to man your own borders. You need to push onto his land to defeat his government and indeed defeat his society if necessary, on his own soil, if the threat of aggression is to be permanently removed. Now, of course, to act so forthrightly, to defend itself with such bold offensive power, and to maintain its freedom, a decent nation must identify with certainty the rightness of its own position and the evil of its enemies. This central moral identification is the one great weapon that can sustain a decent nation in a war with savages. Without that moral certainty, it will lose the will to sustain the fight, irregardless of its military power. If a nation fails to identify its own self-interest, if it substitutes action against secondary targets for actions against its enemies, or if it bases its interests on the needs or desires of others, then it may progressively weaken itself by doing the wrong things. When that nation finally realizes that it needs to attack the enemy directly, it may be too late to avoid a major conflagration or even defeat. America is approaching this point. It will be there if these Islamic fundamentalists get nuclear bombs. Now let us examine the lessons of history. What do they show us about this subject? And I'd like to go to my first lesson for tonight. I have four to go through very briefly. The first lesson is in ancient Greece. Now, in the early 5th century BC, 490 to 480 BC, the Greeks fought off two invasions by an aggressive enemy from the east, Persia. Over 50,000 Persians landed at the beach at Marathon in 490 BC, and some 10,000 Athenians drove them off to the beach and back onto their ships. The Persians returned home defeated, only to regroup their forces under a new king and to attack again, this time with a massively larger army. This army, quote, drank the rivers dry, unquote, as they marched into Athens and sacked the city not once, but twice. Now, every student of history knows about the Battle of Thermopylae, where Leonidas the Spartan and 300 heroes held off hundreds of thousands of Persians for 3 days, and of the battles at Salamis and Plataea that followed. The Persians again returned home in defeat, and they never attacked again. Now, these are the so-called Persian Wars, and this is the story which students are routinely told in high school and in universities. But these defensive battles tell only part of the story. Here is the rest of the story. When the Persian king's general was beaten the first time, he retreated back to his homeland. Now, the king, given this defeat, was diminished in the eyes of his subjects. This is a position that is deadly to a tyrant. So this tyrant vowed revenge against the Athenians. He asked a slave to remind him daily at meals, "Sire, remember the Athenians," so that he could keep the spirit of vengeance alive. Over the next 10 years, this king died, and his son took over, taking up the cause of avenging his father. It was this king who marched into Greece the second time and sacked Athens. Now, after this king was beaten, he again went back home. But this time, following the second invasion, this time the Greeks did not stop at their own beaches. They followed the Persian king, driving into the Aegean Sea, making alliances with the city-states on the islands, coercing them if necessary, and slowly pushing Persian influence out of the ocean surrounding Greece. Over the next 30 years, they drove the Persians off of Andros, Naxos, Cyprus, Samos, Lesbos, Rhodes, and onto their own homeland. Their final victory, the final victory of the Greeks over the Persians, and the establishment of a permanent peace, is found not on the homeland of the Greeks at all, but on Persian soil, decades later, when the Athenians beat the Persians on Persia at the battles of Eurymedon River and elsewhere. Tradition has it that a final peace was made in the 440s BC, nearly 40 years after the second invasion. The vital strategic observation is this: the Greeks beat the Persians and permanently removed the threat of foreign invasion by beating the Persians on the homeland of Persia. The simple fact is that the homeland defense of the Greeks was at best a delaying tactic, an action that saved the Greeks for the moment and gave them time to build up their forces. But it was the battles on Persian soil that removed the threat permanently. Why? Well, the reasons for this can be found in the attitude of the Persian king. During the second invasion, he had set up a massive gold throne on a mountain in Greece overlooking a bay so that he could observe the great victory of his navy over the Greeks. And as he watched his navy being defeated, he jumped up out of his golden throne 3 times, crying out his angst at the world that would not allow him the victory he thought was his. See, he went from not knowing who the Athenians were to vows of vengeance against them to utter respect for their power. What beat the Persians and allowed Western civilization to flourish was that the Greeks destroyed the will of the Persian king to fight. And they did this by destroying all hope in him that he could win. The Persian king never attacked the Greeks because he was shown on his own soil that he could not win. He could not afford, see, to be defeated again in the eyes of his subjects. The lesson here is that one cannot win a war by exempting the homeland of the enemy from attack. One has to beat his will with powerful attacks that demonstrate the bankruptcy of his position. This is what won the war against the Persians. Now let me ask, can you imagine what would have happened if the Greeks had declined to attack Persia outright? Called the war a war against the king, but not against the Persian people? claiming that the Persian king had hijacked a great nation, thanking the Persians for their prayers, vowing to try not to hurt them, and apologizing if they did. The Persians would have taken this as the grossest weakness. Such a policy would have empowered the king. Those willing to fight him would have held no hope of success, and those loyal to the king would have hardened their loyalty to him. Where then would Western civilization be today? But the Greeks were not appeasers. When the Persian king sent envoys to Sparta demanding symbolic earth and water, see, back then they'd send envoys, and what you do is give him a jar of earth and a jar of water to take back home, which symbolized his superiority over you on land and on sea. When the envoy showed up in Sparta and asked for the symbolic earth and water, the Spartans threw the ambassadors into a well and told them to get their earth and water there. And I remind you that the Persians are the Iranians. The Persians are the ancient Iranians. Now, these observations, that those who value freedom must project power outward against the homeland of the enemy, not merely forcing his physical retreat, but also breaking his will to fight, appear over and over again in history. They are lessons we had better take seriously. So now I turn to a second example today. Ancient Rome, both in her rise and in her fall. And first, I'd like to discuss an important war during the rise of Rome, the Punic Wars, three Punic Wars against Carthage, and in particular, the Second Punic War. So we move ahead in time now to the 260s BC. By this point, the city of Rome had grown from being a simple, isolated, a small town to a position of dominance over the Italian peninsula. By this point, Rome had come into contact with Greek and Carthaginian cities on southern Italy and Sicily. She came into conflict with Carthage over the island of Sicily, where she engaged in a war to the death with Carthage, her only serious rival in the Western Mediterranean. Now, these are the so-called three Punic Wars. The wars ended in 146 BC with the total destruction of Carthage. So I'd like to consider the second of these wars, the Second Punic War. First, some background. The First Punic War, which ended in 241 BC, resulted in Carthage negotiating a surrender with Rome, turning over the prisoners to Rome, giving up the island of Sicily, and retreating to her homeland. Now, see, remember, Carthage is on the north coast of Africa. She came into conflict with Italy, with Rome over Sicily, which is 90 miles away, and it's only 2 miles to Italy. So whoever controls southern Italy and Sicily and Carthage can cut the Mediterranean in half and basically control the entire known world at the time. In this battle with Carthage, Carthage was defeated and was pushed back to her own soil. But the Romans never attacked Carthaginian soil directly. The Carthaginians were still strong at home. They had just lost Sicily, and they had lost all the islands in the Mediterranean, but they were still intact at home. Like Persia after the first invasion of Greece, and like Germany after World War I, and like North Korea today, Carthage was unbeaten at home and was able to prepare the fight again. And in fact, in all three cases, they never considered the first fight as actually being over. They just considered it to be a momentary setback. You know, the war in Korea today is technically still active. It's simply in a ceasefire stage right now. So Carthage's great general, Hamilcar, took his son Hannibal to an altar of the Punic god Baal. And he had the 9-year-old boy lay his hand on the altar and swear eternal hatred of all things Roman. This symbolizes the motivation to return to the fight that Carthage's generals embodied. Hannibal then went with his father, and they traveled from Carthage across North Africa, across Gibraltar, up into Spain, and they established a major capital in Spain. In other words, they were pushed back to their homeland. They could no longer confront Rome directly on Sicily, so they outflanked Rome by going up into Spain, projecting their power out. She spent Carthage and her leaders spent the next 20 years building a major base in Spain. Carthage fortified Spain, consolidated her allies, and built a new city, New Carthage. She projected her power out from her own homeland, but to the west of her enemy. Rome, in fact, consciously or not, but in fact, granted Carthage these territorial ambitions. The young Hannibal soon took over as general. Building on his power, he took control of nearly all of Spain. In fact, he controlled the entire Spanish peninsula except for one small town, Saguntum, which he prepared to besiege and to conquer. So a faction loyal to Rome in this town appealed to Rome for help, sent envoys to Rome and said, help us, protect us from Carthage. The Romans then issued an ultimatum to Carthage. Recall your general from Spain or face war. And Carthage said, we choose war. So the Romans have given an ultimatum to Carthage to withdraw from Spain. The Carthaginians have rejected the ultimatum and chosen war. So the Romans then delayed. They did not boldly attack Hannibal in Spain. Their ultimatum was without teeth. This failure to act left the initiative to Hannibal. And there's one very important lesson that comes out of this. Never make an ultimatum that cannot be backed up with force. It simply grants a pretense to an enemy to start a war. So Hannibal responded, not by waiting for Rome to attack him on Spain, but by boldly marching an army over the Alps into the homeland of Rome in 218 BC. He marched an army of some 90,000 infantry and 10,000 horsemen north of Spain, across southern Italy, over the Alps, and into Italy, and he mounted a blitzkrieg against the Italian peninsula. By the time the Romans sailed towards Spain, Carthage was already entering Italy. This forced Rome to pull her troops back, put her into a defensive position, and set the fighting on Italy. Over the next 10 years, Rome faced a series of defeats by Hannibal on her own soil, on Italy. Attempts to fight Hannibal and Italy were disastrous. In the first 3 years, some 70,000 Roman soldiers were killed or captured in battle. Now, what was Rome going to do about this? Here is Rome sitting here, you know, as the capital of Italy, and it's got this foreign army ravaging up and down the coast. What is it going to do about this situation? Well, they faced an alternative. Rome's general and major political leader at the time was Fabius Maximus. And he had a policy the opposite of boldness, one of delaying. He's in fact known in history as Fabius Cunctator, Fabius the Delayer. How'd you like to go down in history as John the Delayer? He's known as Fabius Cunctator, Fabius the Delayer, due to his explicit policy of avoiding battle with the Carthaginian army and delaying. Now, although this made sense in the short term in order for Rome to buy time for Rome to build up its forces, the situation continued for years. This policy of delay was institutionalized in the Roman Senate, which Fabius largely controlled. As long as delay was the policy, the war dragged on, stalemated at best. An entire Roman generation grew used to a foreign army on Italy. Attempts to bring the war to the homeland of Carthage or to Spain were ineffectual and not prosecuted with determination and focus. Now, events over these years are very complex, and the Second Punic War is fully as complex as the Second World War. So I'm going to cut right to the essential point. By 211 BC, Rome had secured some success in Sicily and elsewhere. But in that year, her two most important generals were killed in Spain and defeated, and her armies pushed back to where she had been 7 years before. In 211 BC, the Romans went into a panic looking for a general to run the army. And they granted permission to a new general, Publius Cornelius Scipio, you can just know him as Scipio, to lead an army to Spain. Scipio was the son of a famous family with many heroes in the past. His father and uncle were the generals that were killed in Spain. His father-in-law had been killed at the Battle of Cannae, where some 50,000 Roman soldiers had been killed. But Scipio was 24 years old, too young, too brash, too much of a hothead, many thought, for such a responsibility. Many assumed that if they gave him command, he would soon be failed and dead and therefore be out of their hair. So in these terms, they gave him command to the army of Spain. He sailed to Spain. He took command of the army, and he set out to destroy the Carthaginian bases and to force them to fight in Spain. He consolidated the Roman position with their Spanish allies, motivated an expanded army. And in a masterpiece of strategy, He avoided battle with the Carthaginian armies and waited until, set the situation up so that the three major Carthaginian armies on Spain, any one of which was as big as his, were at least a week's march away from the capital, New Carthage, and he mounted a lightning attack on New Carthage and took the city of New Carthage. This destroyed Hannibal's primary base of support, undercut the morale of the Carthaginian army, caused massive defections among the Spanish allies, and the Carthaginian generals were now tied down into a defensive action themselves and would be unable to act until they reestablished their own power in Spain. His father and uncle, in 7 years, had not been able to get anywhere near New Carthage. He did it in the first spring. Events are complex. He soon returned home to Italy as a hero, is the upshot, and demanded the resources to attack Carthage directly. He said, Hannibal's army is still on Italy. Let's end this war. How do we end the war? We don't end the war by delaying at home or by fighting, even fighting Hannibal's army at home. You fight Carthage directly in her capital. And he faced conservative opposition in the Senate to this plan, however. Fabius the Delayer laid out the essence of a defensive mentality, and it's important. He gives the best argument that's ever been made for adopting a defensive position. Quote, why don't you apply yourself to an attack on Hannibal's army here, he said, and carry the war in a straightforward manner to where Hannibal is, rather than pursue the roundabout course of going to Africa and expecting that Hannibal will follow you there. Unquote. Scipio answered him point by point, including the following, quote, provided that no impediment is caused here, meaning in the Roman Senate, you will hear at once that I have landed, that Africa is blazing with war, and that Hannibal is preparing to depart from our country. I shall, Quintus Fabius, have the opponent that you assign me, Hannibal, but I shall draw him after me rather than be kept here by him, unquote. See, Scipio understood the essential point. The enemy was not Hannibal's army. The enemy was Carthage. And that was, and the roundabout way of going about things was to attack the army and to leave Carthage free and clear. The direct action was to go against Carthage. See the two different strategies. In 206 BC, 12 years after Hannibal's invasion of Italy, and I ask you to remember this, this army, this Carthaginian army, has been on Italy for 12 years now. Scipio sailed to Sicily in 30 ships that he built or restored himself, staffed by 7,000 volunteers. The Senate refused to allow him to conscript troops, and they gave him no money. The extent of their help was to allow him to go. Scipio was proud of the fact that his expedition cost the Roman state virtually nothing. He used voluntary contributions from allies as well as the money he had gotten from Carthage's own capital in New Carthage in Spain. He spent over a year building up his forces on Sicily, repairing his ships, and re-enlisting thousands of Roman soldiers who had been unjustly exiled to Sicily for cowardice after major losses in Italy. See, the Senate blame these poor soldiers for the losses on Italy instead of their idiot generals. And they actually exiled them to Sicily. These poor men had been on Sicily for 10 years now, exiled from their homes. Scipio went down and enlisted them into his army. He had one motivated army. These soldiers were itching to regain their honor and their homeland. Scipio then launched a powerful attack on Africa, threatening Carthage itself. In a bold raid on two enemy camps at once in a single night, he killed thousands of enemy soldiers and forced Carthage into a defensive position. What was the result in Carthage? Well, these are the words of the Roman historian Livy. Quote, wild reports that the Roman fleet with Scipio in command had arrived on Africa caused universal panic in Carthage. Nobody had any clear idea of the number of ships the messengers had seen and the size of the raiding force. And sheer fright caused them to exaggerate everything they had heard. The result was a wave of terror, followed quickly by depression at the thought of the grievous change in their fortunes. Only lately they had had an army before the walls of Rome, yet now the tide of war had turned and they were doomed to watch the siege of Carthage, unquote. What do you think the Carthaginians did? Who wants to get an A? What did the Carthaginians do? They immediately sued for peace and they recalled Hannibal from Italy, and 16 years of guerrilla war was over on Italy. The peace on Africa fell apart when Hannibal returned. Hannibal came back to Carthage and offered terms to Scipio. And Scipio said, I cannot accept terms from a defeated enemy general. It is his job to accept the terms that I give, not to negotiate with him. So he walked away from the negotiations, and they met on the battlefield of Zama, where Scipio caught the two greatest generals in the world, in the two strongest countries of the world, at the absolute prime of their power, met on this battlefield. Scipio caught Hannibal in a double encirclement movement and routed his army. Hannibal ran away to the east into exile, and the Carthaginians sued for peace on unconditional terms. Scipio was given the title of Africanus, the man who beat Africa. The first Roman that I know of actually named after the place that he had beaten. The peace he made was firm, tough, and fair. He was appointed by the Senate to administer the peace. He made a peace that was firm, tough, and fair, and in fact, the peace lasted over 50 years, two generations, which is virtually unprecedented in the ancient world until the next generation of Romans broke it. See, Scipio understood that a peace had to be made on proper terms if it was to last. Now, despite many details that I've left out, the overall conclusion here is inescapable. As long as Rome fought a delaying war on Italy, mired down in insipid debates in the Senate, the war dragged on, Rome remained in a virtual state of siege, and soldiers fell in droves in indecisive battles. Town after town on Italy faced a nightmare of siege by Hannibal and then relief by the Roman army. As soon as Scipio took the battle off the Roman homeland to Spain and then to Carthage, fighting with audacity and contempt for his enemy rather than from hesitancy and fear, thinking strategically and projecting his power outward, causing panic in Carthage rather than allowing panic to take root in Rome, the war was soon over. The strategic lesson is obvious. Do not allow the fight to continue on your own territory. Think strategically. Hold the full context of the situation across time and space. Identify the heart of the enemy's power, then set a plan to rip it out. Now, this may require preparation. See, Scipio had to settle affairs in Spain before moving against Carthage. And the lesson is not always attack now. But when you have the power to do so, and the situation is established the way you need it to be established, then bold, audacious action wins the war. The strategic principle remains, get the war off your homeland and onto the territory of the enemy. No lawful country should ever get used to foreign enemies inside its own borders. Once the decision is made, put your best general in charge of the actual fighting. Give him the support he needs and let him go get the job done. Politicians must not meddle in military tactics. The biggest threat to victory, Scipio said explicitly, was not the Carthaginians, but the Roman Senate. This was true. The only thing that could have beaten him was a senatorial order to stay home. Recognize the importance of human motivations. Destroy the enemy's will to fight. Attack his psychological support. Make him and his allies afraid. Panic his cities. Embolden your own people. Show him his vulnerability and show your troops their superiority. Don't accept that you are a minor power and he is somehow strong, which is a very serious error that America has made in the Middle East. Make your capital safe, force him to defend his own. Don't strengthen him by appeasing him, deny him what he wants, and show him that he cannot have it. Now, this last lesson, the need to recognize human motivations and to empower yourself and demoralize the enemy, has been central to every case we've seen so far. It's vital to show that fighting on your side brings rewards, while fighting for the enemy brings only suffering. And ultimately, this is not a construct. It is true. Freedom is good, and it would be a real shame if the supporters of freedom failed to heed these lessons. So let us move ahead 500 years to a third example, to Rome's fall, to illustrate the destructive consequences of a defensive position. Now, during the 500 years following the great successes of Scipio and others, Rome had risen to a great power and then had declined to the point where she was unable to defend her own borders, and those borders collapsed. Soon the eternal city of Rome itself was sacked, the homeland defense failed utterly. The seeds of this had been planted in previous centuries. By the 200s AD, see, 500 years later than Scipio, military actions in the Roman Empire had become primarily ad hoc. The emperor reacted to threats from barbarian attacks on an individual basis, running here and there to put down unceasing attacks. He would hear that there was an uprising in Gaul, so he'd run up to Gaul to put that down. While he's putting that down, he'd get word that the Goths are invading by the Danube River, so then he'd run over there and he'd put that down. Then he'd run down to the east and take care of Palmyra, and while that's happening, the Egyptians are revolting, and then the Gauls are at it again, and everything is ad hoc. It's kind of like the way we're defending our borders today, hoping to find, you know, that needle in the haystack. By looking at individual actions instead of the broad strategic plan. In each case, the general would drive the barbarians back to their borders, enlist many of the attackers in his own army as allies, and declare victory. Peace would hold until the next inevitable attack. Now, in the 260s AD, one of these generals, the new Emperor Aurelian, probably an emperor you've probably never heard of, the Emperor Aurelian, he ruled for 5 years, briefly broke out of this mold. He did two things worthy of note for us tonight. The first was to wage an offensive war against the Goths and other barbarian invaders. At this time, Italy and the city of Rome itself faced an attack from the Goths, the second in 2 years. Twice at this time, the Goth army was inside Italy, standing on Roman roads, leading with a straight open shot right to the city of Rome itself. Aurelian drove the Goths back off of Italy to Rome's borders. And then he kept going further into Eastern Europe. He drove up into the Danube River Valley area near the Black Sea. He drove into their own villages and camps. He killed their king. He smashed their society and moved them physically to an area of his choosing. He established a buffer area between Rome's borders and her enemies. As a result, Rome did not face another attack from the Goths for almost 125 years. Aurelian's boldness may have saved the empire. He took the same kind of actions against other problems in the East and in Gaul. And in fact, when he came to power, the Roman Empire was effectively divided into thirds and was killing itself by internal fighting. Within 5 years, he had reunited the empire. However, Aurelian's offensive action against the Goths was not his longest-lived achievement. We get to the second thing that's important for us tonight. After beating the Goths and others, he went to Rome. There he found a demoralized city, a city racked by the worst rioting in centuries, paralyzed by economic collapse and by fear of foreign attack. And then he recognized his own inability to defend Italy. He faced the fact that he could not defend the city of Rome permanently. So to protect Rome, Aurelian did something that had not been necessary for hundreds of years. He institutionalized a homeland defense. He built defensive walls around the city of Rome. And in doing so, he signed Rome's death warrant. No greater symbol of Rome's power could have been seen than in the fact that she was an open city, positioned on a pacified peninsula, defended not at city limits by walls and checkpoints, but rather on far-off borders by a paid professional army. For hundreds of years, it had been inconceivable for a foreign force to invade Italy itself. Rome carried a myth of invincibility. At the height of her empire, every Roman could see this power and this confidence, not in city walls, but in the openness of the roads that led to Rome. This is true power, see? Free, open cities. No greater renunciation of that power, that confidence, and that civilization could have been seen than in the building of those walls around Rome. They were not signs of strength and efficacy, but rather admissions of weakness and defeat. Italy was vulnerable. By the time of Aurelian, centuries after victory over Carthage, Rome's need to rely on defensive walls at home would have been visible directly to every Roman. From now on, every Roman had to see, as an ever-present reality, every day, the defensive walls needed to protect him from the constant possibility of invasion. These walls could not save Rome, but they could remind every Roman that he was perpetually at risk. This sense of physical vulnerability now began to permeate everyday Roman life. This, I submit, is the true fall of the Roman Empire. And so it is for us. As the Romans were told to accept city walls to protect them against barbarians that never should have been allowed into Roman provinces, so we are told to get used to anti-aircraft guns around our cities to protect us against enemies that we are unable to stop abroad. These are our walls of Aurelian, visible symbols of an institutionalized permanent state of siege made necessary because of an unwillingness to face down and destroy foreign enemies. This, we are told, is now the norm. This is what we are supposed to get used to. But this, I submit, is precisely what we must never get used to. The walls of Aurelian and our homeland defense are the concrete embodiment of what Ayn Rand called the malevolent universe premise. It is the idea that evil is powerful and that the good is weak. This idea is the directly opposite of her philosophy, which is that the good is strong and the evil is weak. But such walls rather concretize the idea that the good cannot prevail over the evil, only hold off the evil for a little while, until the next inevitable attack. And as Aurelian told every Roman that he had to cringe before the possibility of a barbarian attack, so the Department of Homeland Security tells us to prepare for the next inevitable anthrax attack. And as Rome's walls told every barbarian that an attack on Italy was within his grasp, so we tell our enemies that an attack on us is possible. Such a concession to evil is far more than evil could ever hope to achieve by its own hand. Such a concession offered by a nation as powerful as the United States is an obscenity. Ayn Rand's philosophy offers the exact opposite view, the benevolent universe premise. In her view, the good is strong and it is effective because it is good. The only power that evil has is to convince the good to cringe before it. But the greatest power of the good is its own awareness of its own goodness and the efficacy that flows from this. And this is the idea that we must keep in mind. Now, what we in fact face today is an emergency. And as Ayn Rand wrote, quote, "An emergency is an unchosen, unexpected event, limited in time, that creates conditions under which human survival is impossible. It is an unchosen, unexpected event, limited in time, that creates conditions under which human survival is impossible. The proper response to an emergency is to end it and get back to normal. A proper response to a flood is to build dams and tame the water, not to create a federal Department of Water Management charged with telling everyone that drowning is a fact of life." The proper response to our emergency today would be forthright, open, unilateral military action against the governments that support this war against America. Now, there is a need to defend the homeland, but not through the permanent searching of the luggage of little old ladies so that we can avoid confronting our true enemies overseas. The homeland defense should last through the duration of the emergency, which we end as quickly as possible in order to get back to normal. Now, to act properly towards an enemy requires a proper view of ourselves and of him. This takes us to a fourth example, the American Civil War. And a representative of this proper attitude is the American general William Tecumseh Sherman, the man who more than anyone else ended the American Civil War. This war, like Hannibal's war in Italy and Rome's war with the barbarians, also bogged down for years in fruitless slaughter. The Union had its cunctator, the delayer, General George McClellan. He exhibited the same desire to avoid confrontation with General Lee that Fabius had shown toward Hannibal. President Lincoln despaired at getting the man to fight and relieved him of command. The result of McClellan's policy was not a sparing of lives and a quick resolution to the war, but rather the opposite, the bloodbath of Antietam. From early expectations that this conflict would be over in weeks, the war turned into a bloody stalemate that butchered over 600,000. As long as pitched battles were fought without direct consequences for the southern heartland, the slaughter and the stalemate continued. The war was not won until Sherman rode boldly into the heartland of the South, taking the war to those who supported the war, destroying its material resources and its motivations. This was his famous March to the Sea, from Atlanta to Savannah in November to December 1864, which was followed by his march north through the Carolinas to meet up with Grant's army and force Lee to surrender. Now, Sherman shows us the proper attitude towards the conduct of the war, and I suggest that if you want to read something on this subject, read Sherman's memoirs. Read his memoirs of his march through Georgia and his march up through the Carolinas. It's the single best thing to read about this. In essence, Sherman refused to exempt the South from the consequences of continuing the war. He also refused to accept moral blame for casualties that resulted from his work to end the war that he had not started. He set out with overwhelming force to cut a 60-mile swath through Southern society, decimating its material and psychological ability to continue the war. Now, consider his attitude towards the war. When the mayor of Atlanta wrote him a letter and accused him of cruelty, he responded, quote, "You cannot qualify war in harsher terms than I will. War is cruelty, and you cannot refine it. And those who brought war into our country deserve all the curses and maledictions a people can pour out," unquote. But he went on, "He did not start this war, and he was doing more than they to end it. And if the U.S. accepted a permanent division with the South, it would result in perpetual war as was occurring in Mexico." Sherman understood that a peace had to be created on proper terms. And to create a lasting peace means establishing the conditions necessary for human life by prosecuting the war to its proper end as quickly as possible. Now, in 1864, Sherman described his plan. Quote, "If we can march a well-appointed army right through Jefferson Davis's territory, it will be a demonstration to the world, foreign and domestic, that we have a power which Davis cannot resist. This may not be war, but rather statesmanship. With 62,000 men, I would move through Georgia. Instead of being on the defensive, I would be on the offensive," unquote. So he moved down and he took the city of Atlanta. And then he set out to set himself and his army across Georgia. But to effect this demonstration, to make this move, his strategy required that he remove all danger to his rear before moving on. So he needed to remove the civilian population from the city of Atlanta so that he would not be vulnerable from the rear. So he said in a letter, quote, "I propose to remove all the inhabitants of Atlanta. If the people raise a howl against my barbarity and cruelty, I will answer that war is war and not popularity seeking. If they want peace, they and their relatives must end the war," unquote. See, Sherman accepted no blame for prosecuting a war that others started. They can end it when they wish. And just to show that he meant what he said, when they ended the war, surrendering honorably, Sherman stopped fighting and became a passionate advocate for a rational reconstruction, often standing between the Union Army and the South, the Union government, I should say, and the South, and try to work out the proper terms of peace. Now consider his attitude toward non-combatants. He gave orders not to destroy wantonly and to see that non-combatants, properly understood, had food. But he attacked with full force if resistance had offered, and especially if the South carried out its orders for a scorched earth policy. Yes, you heard me right. It was the South that had a scorched earth policy. He refused to sacrifice his own men to others. In a correspondence with his opponent, the Confederate General Hood, General Hood told Sherman that it was Sherman's fault if cannonballs hit civilians in Atlanta, which Hood controlled. Sherman replied that it was Hood's job to move civilians from the areas near buildings in which soldiers were firing on his troops. In other words, he accepted no blame for civilian deaths in areas that he did not control. See, such a tactic only works if the defending power is willing to accept such unearned guilt. Such a ploy did not work on Sherman. Now consider his attitude towards the enemy. Sherman recognized something of Southern society and of the need to destroy the will to war. As a student of history and the best read man in the Army, and a man who had lived in the South and been president of a military academy in the South, He recognized that there was a spirit in the South that was both very powerful and ultimately corrupt, at least as held by many Southern leaders. This spirit had to be broken if the war was to be won. Many Southern leaders were detached from the consequences of the war they had started. Hot-headed legislators were inciting war against the North, yet not seeing the results directly. They were detached from reality. The causal chain, see, between their advocacy of war and the consequences for them was broken. Sherman aimed to bring it to them to reestablish this causal connection. Sherman understood that by failing to take a war to a population that supports it, one exempts that population from the fruits of the action and simply drags the conflict on longer. People cannot be allowed to work all day and party all night while sending supplies and psychological comfort to fuel a war that they've started elsewhere. In a letter to Union General Thomas, Sherman said, and this is the most important quote of the evening, quote, "I propose to demonstrate the vulnerability of the South and to make its inhabitants feel that war and individual ruin are synonymous terms," unquote. At one point, Sherman came into the plantation of a Southern politician who had incited war for years against the North. Upon Sherman's approach, the so-called leader ran for his life, ordering the civilians to stand against Sherman's army, leaving behind exhortations to the civilians to make this kind of a stand. So Sherman moved into his plantation. He ordered that the food be distributed to the people left behind so that non-combatants would not starve once his army had taken what it needed. And then he ordered the place burnt to the ground. In his words, he said, quote, "spare nothing," unquote. For that Southern leader, war and individual ruin were now identical. The causal connection between taking up arms against America and personal destruction had been established. And this is what we need today, a reestablishment of the law of causality. Throw a stone into the air and it falls to the ground. Touch a hot stove and you're burned. Wage war against America and fire falls out of the sky onto you and everyone you associate with, inevitably like a fact of nature. These were the results of Sherman's work. In 6 weeks, he cut through Georgia, ruined the railroads, plantations, and motivations of those who owned human beings like chattel property, established the conditions where Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation could actually mean something, took Fort McAllister, which had withstood 2 years of sieges, in 15 minutes. He then captured Savannah, along with its arms, including 150 heavy guns, without firing a shot. The North erupted in celebration. The Confederates had held Fort Sumter in Charleston Harbor, which was the original place where they had first fired on the Union garrison. They had held it for 4 years. The Union had dropped 7 million pounds of artillery shells on this small island, and the Southerners had never surrendered. When they heard that Sherman was coming, they abandoned it without a fight. See, that's overwhelming force. His casualties of 62,200 men who left Atlanta, 103 killed. Total Confederate losses, under 500. This was in an age when 10,000 boys could die in a single morning in pitched battles. General Grant had once lost 10,000 men in 20 minutes at Cold Harbor. See, Sherman replaced this awful arithmetic, what Grant called the awful arithmetic, with a better plan. He cut up through the Carolinas, and in 4 months the war was over. Any evaluation of Sherman must not fail to consider the thousands who would have died had he mired down in set battles and failed to cut supplies to the army that faced Grant in the North. Sherman saved more lives than any peace activist. The lessons to be drawn from this should be obvious. Don't exempt those who declare and fund a war from its consequences. Don't allow civilians in the rear to supply an army that is killing your soldiers on your territory. Don't allow them to continue to think that they are winning. Don't grant that they're okay for continuing the war and you're somehow wrong for ending it. Don't accept guilt for casualties in a war declared by others. Now, don't get me wrong on this. Sherman could not have won the war alone. Grant had Lee occupied in the North, just like Scipio had to tie the Carthaginians down in Spain before attacking Carthage. But the war could not have been won decisively without his bringing it to those who had started it. Had America accepted a permanent division with the South, Sherman was right. Permanent hostilities could have resulted, and generations might have remained slaves. To destroy the root of such a war was a necessary action, and one best done quickly than dragged out. And after all, isn't that simply justice? History is clear about the need to project power outward, beyond one's borders, into the heartland of an enemy. Nothing succeeds like success, and it is a fatal error to think that winning emboldens an enemy. Benjamin Netanyahu was right when he told a government committee a week after September 11th that the motivations of a terrorist are not hopelessness, but rather hope. He hopes and expects that he can win. He must learn that this is not so. It is fatal to teach an enemy that he could profit from aggression. It is fatal to let him to achieve profit from his starting a war. Appeasement causes wars. One final example. In the lead up to World War II, France and England submitted appeasement for opposition to Germany. In 1936, Germany moved a small force into the Rhineland, the area between France and Germany. Many German generals thought that Hitler had overreached himself and were willing to confront Hitler if he failed. Hitler, arguably, could not have survived the pullout from the Rhineland. It was revealed at the Nuremberg trials that the commanding generals had ordered his troops to withdraw if any opposition was faced. One Frenchman with a machine gun and the orders to pull a trigger could have forced this retreat and ended the Hitler regime. But there was no opposition from abroad, and opposition in Germany was not emboldened. Unlike the Persian king, who was belittled before his subjects, Hitler was strengthened by the profit he received from his threats. At the end of that month, he held a plebiscite in Germany and received something like over 90% of positive votes. British appeasement of him was an active cause of World War II. Now, appeasement is the granting of demands to an aggressor in the hope of buying peace. Appeasement is the exact opposite of justice. See, the person making a just demand is not an aggressor, but a person asking for what is just. To grant a just demand is not appeasement. It is recognizing reality and recognizing justice. Appeasement is entirely different. It is giving in to blackmail in the hope that a blackmailer will quit because his blackmail is successful. Why should anyone who would ever use blackmail to begin with quit because it works? History shows that appeasement has only brought war and destruction. Those who want peace must reject this evil doctrine. Who is the true peacemaker? Wilson and his peace without victors in 1919, or Patton who smashed the German state in 1945? Who created the real peace? Those who accepted the division between the two Koreas, or those who atom bombed Japan until they gave up their evil regime? Who is better off today, the Koreans and their neighbors, or the Japanese and their neighbors? Who is the moral force? Sherman, who forced the surrender of the slaveholding South, or the UN today who grants a seat on the Commission for Human Rights to a country with slavery? Where was America successful? Waging total war on our own behalf against Germany or Japan, or fighting to a draw in Korea. Now ask yourself if American appeasement of the supporters of Iran can lead to anything except evil. Project out across time and space and answer the question of an Iran, a Persia, with nuclear bombs. Now, I will not concede that peace protesters work for peace. In fact, despite proclamations otherwise, they are, in fact, pro-war. Despite claims to good intentions, they establish the conditions that lead to war. Now, pacifism, in its unadulterated form, is a moral commandment not to use force, even in retaliation, irregardless of consequences. As one Christian pacifist recently said at my university, his pacifism is not intended to be effective. It is a matter of faith. Now, I submit an ineffective pacifism is, by definition, war. A pacifism that does not intend to be effective is a pacifism that expects to create war and is not deterred from its actions by this expectation. But a peace exists. It is real if it exists in fact, and not in someone's dreams, hallucinations, wishes, or prayers. The true peacemakers are those who draw on the lessons of history, work to understand the nature of human nature, and establish the conditions needed for human life. There is no peace under a tyrant. He maintains order by incessant murder. He has to be removed before there is any hope of freedom and peace in that society. Now, here is a quote from Ayn Rand. Quote, she's speaking now about the internal condition of a country, not the foreign relations, but it applies. Quote, if some, quote, pacifist society renounced the retaliatory use of force, it would be left helplessly at the mercy of the first thug who decided to be immoral. Such a society would achieve the opposite of its intention. Instead of abolishing evil, it would encourage and reward it, unquote. And so it is for international affairs. It is vital for us to recognize these lessons. To save ourselves by projecting massive power outwards requires us to know with clarity and certainty what our core values are and why they are good. This means not being diverted from our main responsibilities and away from the main danger by desires to do good for other people. For us, the danger is found in altruism. We cannot fight and win a war if we continue to focus our time and energies on hopeless humanitarian missions, such as spending billions building democracy in Iraq. Witness today the overextension of U.S. military ground forces all over the world, while immediate threats to America's very existence are granted immunity from our might. Now, the perfect metaphor for the Bush administration's vulnerability here is the image of two airplanes flying over Afghanistan. One is dropping bombs, precision guided to avoid hitting a mosque, and the next dropping peanut butter. Patriotism drops the bomb, but altruism drops the food, since it is only by self-sacrifice to others that Mr. Bush thinks he can be moral. Thus, he presides over the largest expansion of the federal budget since President Johnson, while avoiding a confrontation with Iran, a religious government indeed, in which faith-based initiatives are constitutional requirements. This cannot work. As long as we base our claim to being right on the good we do for others, we will never be able to focus with clarity and certainty on our own self-interest, and we will never protect freedom as it so desperately needs to be protected today. Only Ayn Rand's philosophy of objectivism gives us the tools needed to make this identification. Life on Earth is sacred. It is the only standard of the good. It makes the very concept of the good possible. Those who preserve the conditions necessary for life as rational human beings are moral. Ours is a moral nation because we protect those conditions for ourselves. Our legacy is freedom and peace. The legacy of our Islamic enemies, as for their mentors, the fascists and the communists, is mass graves. It is Ayn Rand's philosophy that allows us to say with certainty, clarity, and purpose that ours is the morality of life and theirs is the morality of death. Never before has this alternative been made so immediately clear to anyone who is willing to see it. Not since Auschwitz have we seen the desire for death as strong as we see in militant Islam. Not since the Japanese kamikaze, which I remind you means divine wind, have we seen suicide adopted as a formal military tactic. And they at least attack soldiers and not children in schools. Never before have we seen young children taught to strap on dynamite, led by their handlers to lie in graves as demonstrations of the peace of death, with a promise of eternal glory for themselves and payments for their families, all because their leaders valued the destruction of the West more than a freedom-protecting state for themselves. We need to recognize a fact that there is only one active force for freedom and for flourishing human life in the world today, the United States of America. Despite errors caused by the corruption of altruism and pragmatism, our goodness is based on the foundation of constitutional liberty and the protection of the individual. Compare our attitude towards Europe after World War II with the attitude of the Soviet Union. Indeed, historians will one day conclude that America was the first nation in history to subordinate the I can to the I should. To base its decisions at home and abroad not primarily on power, but on what is right. When Kofi Annan asserts that America's self-defense needs the sanction of the United Nations, else we will not be legitimate, we need to tell him with certainty and vigor that he needs the sanctions of the United States, or he will not be legitimate. It is not a consensus among thieves that establishes the moral legitimacy of a person or a nation, but rather that nation's commitment, in fact, to the conditions necessary for life proper to man. To do what is right, the United States must reassert the law of causality on Earth by reestablishing the conditions, the connection between making war on us and personal destruction. Those who declare themselves enemies of human life have only one life to lose, their own, and we must not allow them to escape the consequences of their decision. Take the war to those who start the war. After all, it is their war. Observe the lessons of history, do away with the Department of Homeland Security, and protect freedom with a solid offense against the enemies of freedom and of the good. Thank you very much.
Take questions on the center mic. And let me just remind you all that we want questions.
Hi, my name is Paul Manfrini, and I immigrated from Italy in 1985. And when I had to fill out paperwork for immigrating, one of the questions was whether I belonged to the Communist Party. And of course, obviously, the hint there was that if I belonged to the Communist Party, there may be negative repercussions. And I assumed that maybe it was illegal to be a communist in the United States. My question is, given the fact that the worldwide Islamic religion has open objectives of the destruction of the American society, why isn't it illegal to be a part of Islam in the same way that it used to be illegal to be a part of the Communist Party during the Cold War?
I think the primary reason that I don't think it should be illegal to be a part of the Islamic nation, to be Muslim, is because Islam is a religion that can be practiced in many, many ways. Clearly, there are moderate Muslims who don't advocate for the killing of Americans. You know, Islam is just like Christianity. I mean, any religion can be practiced in, if you will, moderation with, you know, in other words, unseriously, and therefore incorporated into it elements, strong elements of reason and strong elements of rationality and secularism and apply religion to only a specific aspect of life. And therefore, it's not a threat. But of course, when you give Christianity political power, you get the Inquisition. When you give, you know, when Christianity is followed consistently, when faith, any faith, is followed consistently, you get violence. So Islam, in that sense, is not unique. The enemy right now is a particular version of Islam. And in that sense, I agree with you. I think that if you adhere to fundamentalist, militant, totalitarian Islam, you can call it different things, but it's, you know, basically to a particular set of writings that advocate violence, that advocate the destruction of the West, that advocate killing, then that should be illegal. Absolutely. Every mosque in the United States in which there is a preacher who preaches this stuff should be closed. You know, the people who are there who are not U.S. citizens should be deported, you know, if they haven't yet committed a violent crime. Those in the United States should be closely monitored. Some of them should be arrested if they've actually incited for violence. Why don't we do that? You know, because we haven't even announced who the enemy is. I mean, according to George Bush, the enemy is terrorism. And as a consequence, terrorists can be Muslim, they can be, you know, Christians, they can be atheists, they can be anything. They can be Arabs, they can be Scandinavians, they can be five-year-old girls, they can be 95-year-old grandmothers.
So he has failed to identify the enemy.
If you cannot fail to identify the enemy, how can you arrest him? How can you deny him citizenship? How can you deny him entry into the United States? How can you know who to search at the airport?
Correct.
So the key is you have to identify the enemy. And once you identify the enemy, for example, if you identify the Nazis as enemy during World War II, then you know. You cannot let Nazis into the country. Nazis who identified as Nazis in the United States have to be arrested. They have to be followed. They have to be watched. Then you can actually do something. And of course, then you can also project your force externally, as Dr. Lewis said. You can go find Nazis and kill them overseas. The same thing with militant Islamists. If you identify who they are, if you are willing to say this is the enemy, then you can go out and kill them. But right now, we're kind of floundering. We're going after Syria, we're going after Iraq, we're going after this, after that. You know, none of these have anything to do with militant Islam, or if they do, they have very little to do with militant Islam. American boys are dying for no reason, instead of identifying who the enemy is and going out and destroying them.
I agree with that, and I'll even take the example of the Nazis one step further. Would the war against Nazis be a war against Germans in America? Well, if a German in America is loyal to America and he knows of Nazis, he will be turning them in. If he doesn't turn them in, then he's aiding and abetting them, and he is one of them. And it's the same thing here. Now, we hear a lot of noise about the possible anti-Arab action in the United States. And basically, look, there was a mosque in Albany, and some guys were caught trying to buy a surface-to-air missile, right? The leaders of the mosque reacted not by saying, oh, boy, that there's somebody here selling a missile. Let's get him out of here because this is a house of God. They reacted instead against the federal government for daring to prosecute them. That whole mosque is part of this movement. It should be closed.
Correct. And one last thing. I agree with you that, of course, there are moderate Islamic believers. But even the moderate Islamic believers, they have a high degree of tolerance for the extremists. So doesn't that make them like they're harboring and aiding the enemy? And I want to close with a quick example that it's not seen so much here in America, but it's seen more in Europe, because in Europe, Muslims are given more freedom, unfortunately. A friend of mine owns a company, a small factory in northern Italy, and the majority of his workers are Muslim. And when 9/11 happened, the attack, he came to work, and they were all partying and jumping with joy, and he was appalled at the immorality of their attitude. So that's how I want to close it.
Look, the standard was that we had to arrest everybody who basically supported, the terrorists. We'd have to close down all American universities. We can't even fire a professor for claiming that the people inside the World Trade Center were the equivalent of Nazis, which is Professor Churchill. But you know, there is a real problem in the way we approach Muslims in the United States. I agree with you. If you do not act condemn, if you do not turn in the bad guys, you are aiding and abetting them. And the legal system should reflect that, and it should definitely reflect that with regard to Muslims in the United States and in Europe. And it's a travesty. Think about what would have happened. Somebody presented. Imagine that the conspiracy theories about, it's really, what was the conspiracy theory? It was the Jews from Florida flew the planes into the World Trade Center to object to the election of Bush. You know, that was circulating in the Middle East for. Now imagine that Jews had done this, right? What would Israel do? I mean, the first thing it would do would be condemn it and hunt them down and help and do everything in their power to aid the United States in, finding these terrorists and killing them and eradicating them. What have the Muslim countries done, and what have Muslims in the United States done? I mean, they jump up to the defense, most of them, not all of them, but most of them, to the defense of any group like the group in Albany who is that is accused of terrorism.
Hi, I'm Richard from San Diego. Interesting topic. So I'm wondering what is the relationship, or how is there a similarity or dissimilarities between World War II and the invasion or bombing and the crushing of the Imperial Empire, Japan, and the subsequent rebuilding, nation building, if you will, and how that compares and contrasts to our sort of invasion of Iraq, et cetera, and our so-called nation building. And then as an aside, if you could address how the powers of the 13 colonies was projected into the king in the 1700s.
Okay, two questions. All right. The first one, as far as Japan is concerned versus Iraq. First thing you notice is that there was no rebuilding in Japan and there was no rebuilding in Germany until the enemy was destroyed. When Germany surrendered in Europe, American troops were starting to get their orders to ship to the South Pacific to take care of Japan. They weren't left in Germany to build. You know, can you imagine if we used the policy being used by the Bush administration in the Second World War? We'd still be in North Africa, establishing a democracy in Algeria as an alternative. We'd at best be in southern Italy. Can you imagine us invading Italy? We'd stop, we'd do the borders in Italy, we'd establish a democracy in Italy as an alternative for the German people. You know, it's ridiculous. In World War II, the enemy was destroyed before there was any nation building anywhere. And that's the first clear difference. We're completely incapable of doing that, if it's even proper to be in Iraq. If it is, and that is the enemy, that's what happens first. Because in World War II, we were fighting a war to destroy an enemy who was out to destroy us for self-interested reasons. And we've lost that today.
Then you can answer the second question, because I don't have a clue what the answer is. I absolutely agree. The first difference is that in World War II, we actually fought the enemy. So that was a good thing. You know, so the Japanese attacked us, so we fought the Japanese. Here, militant Islamists, totalitarian Islamists attack us, and we attack Iraq. No relation to the people who attacked us. I mean, there's a kind of a relationship, but no direct relationship. So the first difference is we actually fought a war against the enemy. Here we're not fighting against the enemy, we're fighting against a secondary power. I agree completely. Then we destroyed them. We annihilated them. I mean, we killed hundreds of thousands of the people. We destroyed every single major city in Japan and in Germany. We're not just talking about Dresden, we're talking about flattening Berlin. Berlin was bombed time and time again. We're not just talking about Hiroshima and Nagasaki, we're talking about every Japanese city was firebombed, with casualties in the tens of thousands of civilians, every single one of those cities. So we destroyed Japanese civilizations, Japanese culture. They were completely on their knees when we entered Tokyo. You know, the difference is, when we entered Baghdad, our soldiers were asked, where's our electricity and where's our water? You know, the soldiers who entered Tokyo, you know, if they were approached at all, were thanked that they were, you know, that the civilians were still alive, the ones that were still alive there. So the attitude of the population remaining alive was completely different. We then went ahead and rammed a constitution down the Japanese throat. You know, the Japanese wrote a constitution, they gave it to MacArthur, and MacArthur looked it over, and he shredded it. And then he wrote a constitution, he said, this is what you're going to do. And they said, okay, because no, they weren't going to argue with MacArthur at that point. So, you know, that's a big difference. But let me step back, you know, we had no obligation, and indeed Ayn Rand was against, and I think she was right, she was against the Marshall Plan. She was against the rebuilding, helping rebuild Europe. She was against the billions of dollars that went into that. She viewed it as a mistake, and I agree with that. It was a sacrifice of American wealth that could have been well spent in the United States by private citizens. It caused higher taxes. It was unjustified. It was a sacrifice of American interest for the sake of German and French. So it would have taken them 20 more years to get to the point where they are today. It's not our responsibility to rebuild our enemy after that. And let me make this point. I think Dr. Lewis made the point during his talk. The reason Germany is peaceful today is not because of the Marshall Plan. The reason Germany is peaceful today is because of Dresden and Berlin and because of Patton, because it was annihilated, because it was defeated so thoroughly and so unequivocally. And so that set of ideas, the ideas of Nazism, were completely discredited. So you might have some neo-Nazis around today, but nobody takes them seriously, because that set of ideas, everybody knows, that leads to Dresden, that leads to and as a fallback, you know, they look to the United States, they look to their own more pro-Enlightenment, you know, history, and adopted those ideas to build a Germany and a Europe for the future. And that's what that's what maintains peace in Europe today, not the Marshall Plan. So it's the same thing is true in Japan. What maintains the peacefulness of Japan is the acknowledgement at the time of the complete corruptness of Japanese imperialism as an ideology, and as a consequence, the adoption of a semi-Westernized, semi-individualistic, semi-capitalist set of ideas that, you know, might at some point crumble because they don't have the full philosophical support that it needs, but has sustained Japan now for 60 years really well. So you have to bring, if you're going to change a culture, you have to crush it first. You have to make it obvious and clear to them, just like the North did to the South, that their way of life is suicidal, unacceptable, ridiculous, and they will be defeated. And then they can start looking around for alternatives. And it's not your responsibility to rebuild them, and indeed that is an act of altruism and a negative. We should not be rebuilding Iraq. You know, it's not our responsibility to establish democracy or anything else in Iraq. If Iraq was a threat, the threat should have been destroyed. And then we can figure out what to do with Iraq later. If it was a threat, and if it was the primary threat, which is not, as we've said, and the primary threats are militant Islam, and therefore Iran and Saudi Arabia would be primary. That was a question about the
what was the other question?
How did the 13 colonies project power and therefore...
Oh, all right. Okay, that's a good question. Now, I'm working on a book on this subject, and you've got to realize that there is that there's a certain context in place for all of this. The lessons that I'm looking at are parallels to us in the present day. And the first thing we have to realize is that we have the capacity to defend ourselves. The colonists back then did not have the capacity to project power onto England. Now, it would be ridiculous for me to say, for example, or anyone to even entertain the idea that Estonia should have attacked Moscow when the Russians took over Estonia. They didn't have the power to do it. The examples I'm concerned with are ones where a nation has that power to do it. Now, I think that in the American colonial war, ultimately, it ends up with the British were unwilling to send the troops over to do the job that was necessary because they were demoralized, because it was known in Parliament that it was an indefensible position. They knew they were treating the colonists wrongly. Plus the fact they were involved in a broader context of wars with the French, which is really what their big interest is. So there's a huge interest in, you know, and there's a lot of examples I would not include in this because the context is so different. I wouldn't include a civil war like the English Civil Wars, where there's no territory being fought over, it's just two guys fighting over the same country. The North and South in the American Civil War had territories. I wouldn't consider the Hundred Years' War, let's say, because that's basically just feudal gangs going at it. There aren't any territories. There has to be a territory and a state to defend that is capable of defending itself for it to be a relevant example. Now, I would say there is an example of a minor country that had no power to touch a larger country directly, but did project its power in an indirect way, and that is how Vietnam, North Vietnam, projected power into America. North Vietnam projected power into America. How? By demoralizing the American people through leftist sympathizers so that the war was not fought by dropping bombs on Hanoi, which was virtually untouched in the war, but rather was fought in the streets of Chicago and in the classrooms of Berkeley. And once that happened, in effect, North Vietnam projected psychological power onto American soil. And that's where you need to know that you're right, you need to know that you're certain, and you need to know whether we should have ever been in Vietnam either. Okay?
You'd be fighting the right war.
Right, fighting the right war, yes.
My name is George Westrom. I'm a veteran of the World War, and the answer seemed simple and short, who the enemy was, you know, Germany and Japan. And I'm a little confused. Now, we've talked a lot about it. Maybe you've answered this, but what is the short answer for who is the enemy today?
The enemy today is militant Islam. And militant Islam has two main political centers in the world. The first is in Iran, and the second is in Saudi Arabia. Iran has declared its new nation, if you want to call it that. Or, you know, this, I think they destroyed the existing nation and went back to a medieval feudal system, theocracy, in 1979 by storming the U.S. embassy in an unprecedented act of war, committing war against U.S. soil. Remember that a foreign embassy is the soil of the mother country. They attacked U.S. soil by taking hostages, and Carter basically did nothing. That was a direct attack on America. Since then, the government of Iran has fostered these militant totalitarian Islamic movements all over the world. They established, just for one example, the Hezbollah movement. Hezbollah means party of God. And Khomeini envisioned a worldwide movement of Hezbollah parties, each in individual countries, that would ultimately unite. That is the enemy. That is the enemy, the government of Iran. And no, these terrorists cannot operate and do not operate without state support. They need territories to operate from. They need places to run their training camps. They need money. They need banks that they can work with. And they need political support. It was incredulous a while back that Syria actually said, why would we hold them responsible for Hamas? All they do, they don't give any real support. All they give is a little political support. Well, a little political support, that is support. For the, you know, what does a government do except political support? So this is the enemy.
Yeah, I mean, the war we're fighting today did not start on September 11th. The war we're fighting today started on November 4th, 1979, with the storming of the embassy in Tehran. And the war has been since then against militant Islam, against fundamentalist Islam, and the only significant country. Afghanistan was ruled for a while, and Sudan was ruled for a while by militant Islamic regimes. But the only substantial country in the Middle East or anywhere in the world ruled by militant Islam is Iran. Until Iran is taken out, no solution, no resolution of this war is possible. Iran funds not only Hezbollah, it funds the Hamas, it funds Islamic Jihad. There are clear connections between the Hezbollah and Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda operatives today are supposedly in Iran, hiding. You know, the hijackers of September 11th traveled through Iran to get to their targets. Iran is at the heart of militant Islam. It is the Berlin, the Tokyo of this war. And as long as we avoid attacking it, we avoid fighting the war. Now, let me add that a second country that shares responsibility with Iraq, Iraq is Shiite and Al-Qaeda is primarily Sunni. This second country that, while its government doesn't explicitly advocate for violence against the United States, like the Iranians just passed, the Supreme Leader of Iran just last week said that before every single prayer that a Muslim makes in Iran, he has to start the prayer by saying something like, Allah, please destroy America, before every single prayer. So, I mean, they've declared war on us a long time ago. They're just continuing. But the second country is Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, while its leadership doesn't declare explicitly war against the United States, people associated with the leadership are clearly funding Al-Qaeda, have been funding them forever. The official mosques in Saudi Arabia have been preaching the most vile, horrific anti-Americanism, anti-Western, anti-Semitic violent actions. That's what's been preached in their mosques. Their charities have been funding terrorism all over the world. And while recently they've been cracking down a little bit because they've been themselves attacked by terrorists, the pattern in their past has always been that they appease, the regime itself appeases the terrorists. As long as the House of Saud believes that the United States will protect them no matter what, they will continue to turn a blind eye to terrorist activity targeted against the United States. If you take out the Iranians and you replace the regime in Saudi Arabia, either by force or just by neglect or by pressure, or that is the end of the war. You choke the financial backbone, the spiritual backbone, the ideological backbone of militant Islam. If the one country that is, run by militant Islamists, that oil revenue goes to fund terrorism, where they thrive, is immune from attack, that is going to continue to embolden the terrorists against us. And we go after secondary, third-level targets like Iraq, or now the big thing is let's go after Syria. Syria is a nothing country that Israel could take care of in 3 days if we let them. I mean, remember Six-Day War? Well, Syria entered the Six-Day War in day three. We're focusing on these insignificant targets while the real enemy, one is immune, the Iranians, and developing nuclear weapons under our nose.
As a right, they're proclaiming.
Yeah, and they claim it's their right. And the Saudis are our allies, where George Bush hugs and invites to his ranch the chief, the sheikh that runs the place. You can't win a war like that. Imagine Roosevelt inviting, one of Goebbels over to the White House.
One final point. Remember something about Iran. When you hear that Iran is a... Remember, in the first Gulf War, 1991, we heard that Iraq was so strong, you never know what we're getting into here. They might tie us down. It could be... right? And in a couple of days, it was gone, and Bush Sr. ended the war 24 hours early, so Saddam stayed in power. The second war, we heard, oh, God, he's really built up now. It's much more stronger than he was the first time. And what happened? 3 weeks later, we were in Baghdad because we dawdled a bit. Remember something about, now we're being told that Iran is not like Iraq. Iran is really strong. Remember something about Iran. Iran fought a war for years against Iraq. Iran could not beat Iraq. Remember that.
Do you think that in order to defeat radical Islam, Wahhabism, the teachings of that, you need the support of the moderate Muslim community? And how would that figure into a tactical battle plan against Saudi Arabia and Iran? And furthermore, what to do about North Korea?
Wahhabism is one element within the militant Islamic framework. Wahhabism is one interpretation of that. It's certainly not the only enemy. Certainly the Iranians are not Wahhabis. And even Al-Qaeda, is influenced by Wahhabi, but there are a lot of different interpretations, and an enemy that takes various guises. But you don't need the help of moderate Muslims. You just have to fight a war. All we have to do is go out and kill the bad guys. Moderate Muslims will help us fight the war if they're convinced that we are committed to fighting the war against a specific, well-defined enemy. We did not need moderate Germans to defeat Nazism. We needed to crush Germany. We do not need moderate Japanese to defeat the Japanese. We needed to crush Japan. If we crush Iran, then the moderate Iranians will take over, and they'll look, hopefully, because we all have crushed militant Islam, that will not be a good model for them to build a new Iran upon. They will then look to the West and look for better models, better ideologies, better thinking, better ideas on which to build a new political system in Iran. And hopefully the same is true in Saudi Arabia, although I think the best you can hope for is probably a dictator who's more pro-Western and less religious. But I don't think there's as much of a pro-Western moderate force like there is in Iran. And then You know, if that's not enough, then you have to go and you have to find these madrasas and these schools where they teach violence in Pakistan and Afghanistan, and you have to shut them down and blow them up if you need to, and you know, and close the mosques here in the United States that preach this kind of stuff, and you have to find the enemy and destroy the enemy. But you know, we're the mightiest power in the history of mankind. We don't need the help of a moderate form of a historically pretty pathetic religion. You know, we don't need that. We don't need the help of anybody to win this war.
Besides, think of the message that is sent. How should we enlist these moderate Muslims? Should we ask their permission? Should we invite? Should we say, "Well, we're going to start a war, but we'll delay until you guys take your position. Are you going to join or not?" What kind of a message does that send? The first thing we said: are you serious about the war or not? You know, and so I reject the whole premise of trying to enlist them.
But they do know.
The way you enlist them is by inviting them to the White House for a Ramadan party a month after September 11th, which is exactly what George Bush did. That's what he did with moderate Muslims.
Given that they live in those countries, they do know who the extremists are.
Yeah, but so do we. It's no secret who the extremists are, because extremists are not afraid to go up on a stand and express their extremism, because they know nothing will happen to them. We don't need anybody's help to find these people. We know who they are, and we know for the most part where they are. Now, I believe that if we exert that kind of force, if we project the kind of certainty, if we identify the enemy and we say this is a war against militant Islam, this is what we're going to do, and we start acting on that, moderate Muslims will start helping us because their lives will be at stake. So, for example, if we go on and we say, Iran, you have, I don't know, I'm going to be generous, you have a week. If the mullahs are still in power in a week, we are going to, you know, destroy every piece of infrastructure in the entire country. You will have no electricity, no water, no nothing. Then, if the moderate Muslims want to help us, they'll go to Tehran in a, you know, one of these mass marches for peace and, you know, kick the dictators out, and then we won't have to go to Tehran, and that'll be it. So, you know, if they help us, great, but it has to be on our terms, and it has to be a consequence of them recognizing that we will actually follow up on our ultimatum. If we just, you know, after what we've done in Iraq and after what we've done in Afghanistan, they'll be waiting outside for the food packages and electricity rather than believing that we'll really destroy them. So if you can project that kind of force in a way that's unequivocal, then I think you will get the aid of the better people within a culture. And you know, that's good. If we can not send Marines to Tehran, I'm all for that. I think if we can win this war with zero casualties, I think we should. And you know, given the amount of power that we have, we should be able to win this war with very, very, very few casualties.
And it helps to clearly define the enemy once again.
Well, yeah, I think that's the key. That's the day Bush declared a war on terrorism is the day we lost this war.
Okay, North Korea, and given the fact that the Bush administration and any other administration is probably not going to pursue this kind of strategy, what's your prophecy? What do you think about the future? What's going
to
happen?
I don't know what North Korea is very hard to predict, and I don't know that I can make a prediction. But let me say this. It's a mess. There is no easy, simple solution like there is, for example, in Iran right now. And the reason is that there are two reasons. One is that North Korea might have nuclear weapons right now, and it would not be hard for them to launch such a nuclear weapon against South Korea, and it might be even feasible for them to launch such a weapon against Japan or some of our other allies. Second, even if they don't have nuclear weapons, they would, in the process of military confrontation, tens of thousands, if not more, South Korean civilians would probably be killed because Seoul is, I think, what is it?
Very, very
close to the North Korean border, and they have artillery that can reach it easily. So it's complicated. If you're going to take out the nuclear capability, you have to do it. You know, I need a lot more intelligence, which I don't have, to know if that's possible without inflaming the entire Korean peninsula and getting a lot of South Koreans killed. The key thing with North Korea has to be to make sure that if they have nuclear weapons, they don't leave North Korea. North Korea is a communist regime that is killing its civilians at a ever accelerating rate. Millions of North Koreans are dying. It is a regime that is not a threat to the United States unless it exports its nuclear weapons or unless it develops ballistic missiles that can reach the United States. And I believe that it can only do that if it is helped by the Chinese or by the Russians or by the Europeans. So we need to somehow find a way to completely, thoroughly isolate the country and make it powerless. Now, again, I'm not ruling on military action if that's feasible. I just don't know if it's feasible. I don't know what the cost would be. You know, we would have to be, you know, you'd need a lot more information to figure that out. The difference between North Korea and Iran is that Iran is where North Korea was just a few years ago, when the problem to North Korea developing nuclear weapons could have been dealt with very quickly and relatively cheaply by taking out whatever remnants of a nuclear program they would have. You know, I don't know. The military strategist could come and say, if you nuke the capital of North Korea, it's all over because the North Koreans won't fight against the South Koreans. And if that's possible, then, you know, that's certainly an alternative.
I want to put a different perspective on North Korea. I'm a historian, so I always ask, where do these things come from historically? And remember something at the end of World War II. When the United States dropped the atomic bomb on Japan, our general in Europe opposed dropping that bomb. Eisenhower opposed it. And he opposed it because he said it would inflame world opinion against us. So if he had been in charge in the South Pacific, the bomb would not have been dropped, and it would probably be 100,000 American deaths invading Japan. Now, Eisenhower was president when he inherited the war from the Korean War from Truman. So he negotiated an end to the war. So remember that North Korea is an example of where we did not project power onto North Korea. If you hear anybody tell you that we're warmongers, and then, in fact, projecting this kind of power on an enemy creates new terrorists and create new enemies. You know, ask yourself, we exempted Cuba. We didn't attack Cuba. Where does Cuba stand right now? We exempted North Korea. Where does North Korea stand right now? Now, where are the countries we did take out? Japan and Germany, the two best examples. Now, if that logic on the other side was anywhere near being right, the Japanese and the Germans ought to be attacking us now, and the North Koreans and Cubans ought to be our staunch allies. But it's the exact opposite. Korea developed as it did because we did not fight the war to win. And the shame of it is, there's lots of shames of it, but one of the shame of it is, at the time we did it out of fear of the Soviet Union, when the Soviet Union was no threat to America. If we had dropped a bomb on North Korea at the time, it probably would have ended the war, the regime would have fallen, and you might have a united Korean peninsula now that's semi-capitalist, and a more rational government than a lot of other regimes, as you see in the South. So put Japan and Germany on one side, put Cuba and North Korea on the other side, and you see the two strategies and the results.
Let me just add, and you might disagree with this. I don't believe we should have been in Korea in the first place. Okay.
No, please. Don't take what I'm saying as an endorsement of the war itself. I can talk about the strategy in Vietnam without reference to whether we should be there.
Sure. And note that we did not have to launch a war against the Soviet Union. Communism was a self-destructive system that ultimately fell apart. It destroyed itself. It fell apart, and once the Soviet developed had nuclear weapons and could launch them against the United States, it made no sense for us to engage in a war, you know, to free the Soviets. It was just then a question of let's make sure we don't do one iota to help them. And indeed, I don't believe it's Ronald Reagan who destroyed the Soviet Union and caused the collapse of the Soviet Union. What I do believe is that it's Richard Nixon who sustained the Soviet Union. That is, if not for the detente of Richard Nixon and the wheat that we kept sending there to feed the Soviets, they would have collapsed in the 70s, not in the 80s, and the Berlin Wall would have fallen earlier, not later. So it is appeasement that keeps these regimes going. And indeed, North Korea today is 5 years ahead or 10 years ahead of where it should be, or where it could have been, if not for all the food we've been giving it since the deal Clinton signed in 1994 with the North Koreans. So North Korea would be an insignificant threat today if that deal would have never been signed. and they would have starved to death, which is basically what they would do. I mean, to this day, right now, we give food to North Korea because we don't want the people of North Korea to suffer from the evil of their regime. Well, until the people of North Korea suffer from the evil of their regime thoroughly, completely, then the regime is going to sustain itself. If we keep feeding the people, the regime is still going to be there. We need to stop evil, as Dr. Lewis said in the talk, evil is impotent. Impotent. It's only through our appeasement that they survive. North Korea is where it is today because we appeased them. The Soviets were where they were because we appeased them. Indeed, the Arab world is where it is today because we appeased them by letting them take over the oil wells which rightly belong to Western oil companies and not to Saudi sheiks. So it is appeasement that made militant Islam even capable of taking over the embassy in Tehran. If you go back and we had never allowed those oil wells to be taken, there would have never been a militant Islamic revolution against us. There would be no terrorism against us today. It's only our weakness that makes our enemies possible. And that is true of communism, the spread of communism, the success of communism. That is true of militant Islam today. They will thrive only to the extent that we are weak, and that has been the history to this day.
Dr. Lewis, that was an excellent lecture. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Brooks, my question is, on the premise that the right ideas can change the world, a nation, a state, a family, and an individual, is the Ayn Rand Institute going to send a copy of this lecture to the Bush administration?
Thank you. I get that. I've gotten that question several times, and the last time I gave this in Denver, somebody said, "You know, couldn't this lecture be heard, you know, by Condoleezza Rice?" And this is my answer. My answer is, I don't think she'd learn anything from it. I mean that, because she was a full, just to take her for an example, she was a full professor of political science at Stanford. She was provost of the university. She was a so-called Sovietologist who studied the Soviet system for 20 years. There's no fact in this talk that she doesn't know. The issue is how she evaluates those facts. And she evaluates those facts from such different premises that she would not come to the same conclusions. I think it's hopeless. I think if she heard this lecture, about 5 minutes into it, she'd get up and walk. I mean, if she was able to express what she's really thinking, you know, she might stay there pragmatically to make a show. But if she could express what she's thinking, she'd walk out of it in 3 minutes. And that's why the issue with the British administration is not bringing them more knowledge. That's not the issue. The issue is understanding the moral way in what we know is to be evaluated. And it's to reject this altruism and this pragmatism and to embrace self-interest as a moral right. So I appreciate the thought, you know, from that question and from the other questions like that. But this, in regard to the Bush administration, it's the wrong premise. They would reject the thought. They would reject the talk and say, they'd say something like, "You're an idealist." One of my colleagues who's a Straussian conservative said to me that I'm an idealist and a utopian because I actually think we could actually win the war. "Don't you realize," he says, "it's much more complicated than that." And I said to him, you'd make a complicated question out of whether I should step in a mud puddle or not. And he said, "Well, that's true. There's a lot to consider. You know, there could be a lot to consider." So, see?
Let me just say that the Bush administration, a month after September 11th, received Dr. Peacock's brilliant essay on what the cause of September 11th and what should be, you know, how the war should be prosecuted. Obviously, that didn't have much of an impact on how they proceeded. Everybody in the White House received a copy of that. It was a full-page ad we put on the New York Times and in the Washington Post, I think. And everybody in Washington got a copy. A lot of people read it, you know. Peter Schwartz's book on foreign policy, which is, I think, available in the back, which is an excellent book on the need for American to assert its self-interest in foreign policy, was mailed to everybody in the White House, to you know, everybody in the Pentagon, to the commanders in Iraq, to 2,500 different people got free copies of that book with no response, zero from 2,500. The differences between our position and the Bush administration's position are fundamental differences. They do not relate to, tactical strategic issues. They don't relate to, the facts of history. They relate to the interpretation of history. They relate to the goal of U.S. foreign policy. They relate to the nature of this war. Is this an ideological war? What is the ideology that we're fighting against? And what do we, as America, stand for? We don't even agree on that. And then how to prosecute a war from a moral perspective. I'm not even talking about strategy. From what is the ethics of war? We disagree on every one of these fundamental issues. I don't think it harms to send a talk like this to them. You don't know what junior guy gets handed this stuff because the senior guy doesn't want to read it or doesn't want to listen to it, and you don't know, you know, that this junior guy might be somebody young who is still open to influence and impact. So absolutely, I think it's a good idea, and I we'll probably do something like that. We've done it in the past, we'll continue to do it, not because we think George Bush or Condoleezza Rice will change, but because maybe Condoleezza Rice had a third assistant who might change and who might have an impact 5-10 years down the road, or might have just a voice within the administration that's worth having. So I wouldn't give up on Washington. I personally have given up on the people running Washington. It's the next level down that I'm targeting.
Okay, I have a couple of questions. Recently, I was in a store, and the clerk that waited on me, I could tell she had a Middle Eastern appearance to her. I said, "Where are you from?" She says, "Iran." I says, "What do you think of what's going on over there?" She said, "Well, I just visited my relatives and I came back from Iran." I said, "What do the people think of us there?" She says, "The young people like America." She says, "The government I don't like, and a lot of the people don't approve of them." So the question is, how do we remove these hate mongers and war mongers in Iran and still keep the feelings of the younger generation? The second question I have is, when 9/11 occurred, I thought for sure there'd be a mass uprising of the Muslim people in America saying, "We don't approve of this. This is wrong. Don't count us as part of this." Instead, no one rose up. Very few voices, which made me think, because they sat back on their posterior and did nothing, that the bulk of them are sympathetic still to Iran. I'd like to hear your comments.
Well, let me. There are two issues about Iran. One is, there's no question that there is a significant, or at least we think there is. I don't know the details of it. We think there is a significant number of people within Iran who are pro-West and who like America. How big that group is, I think it's really hard to tell. And I think that I don't think we should overestimate the size of that group. And I don't think we should use what Iranians in the United States are telling us as an clear indication of that, primarily because the people they communicate with tend to be the more educated and the more westernized. So I don't think they're lying to us. I just think that they're exposed only to... My suspicion is a big chunk of the so-called opposition in Iran are just more moderate theocrats. So, you know, this Khatami, who is the president of Iran right now, was voted in as a moderate president. But, you know, he's just believes in a little bit more moderation in applying Sharia law, to Iran. It's not that he believes in freedom or is pro-Western. Second thing is that if it is true that there is a significant pro-Western population in Iran, then I think the United States should give them every opportunity to take out their regime themselves. And I gave you a scenario a few minutes ago where we give them a week to do it, and if they don't do it, we go in and do it ourselves. And, you know, people have to fight for their own freedom. It's not the responsibility of the United States to fight for other people's freedom. They need to fight for their own. If the Iranian opposition really wants freedom and really wants to love America, and they don't want us to invade because they won't feel right about us if we invade, which is a little bizarre. But, you know, we're going to free them from this oppressive regime, but they don't want, that would be foreign intervention and they don't want it. Then, you know, then let them fight for it, let them do it. Otherwise, if it is necessary for us to go in there to eliminate the Iranian regime, then we need to do it without taking into account what these people think or feel. In other words, if they truly oppose the regime and they truly support America, they will be cheering as we drop the bombs. I'll give you an example. The French resistance in World War II did not ask the Allies not to bomb French cities. They said, please bomb French cities. And you know what? I hope I'm not in one, but if I am one, this is the price you for the fight for freedom. I'm risking my life. But bomb us, day and night, bomb us. And indeed, the, whatever freedom fighters, partisans they were in Germany who objected to Hitler wanted Dresden flattened. They, I mean, they wanted that because they realized that that's what it would take to free Germany. So if the Iranians are truly pro-American, then they would be the first to advocate bombing Tehran, if that, assuming that's the only way to get rid of the Iranian regime, and they couldn't do it themselves. So I think that we should, you know, we need to pursue what is in our self-interest. We need to do what will defeat the enemy and minimize the loss of American lives. And I think that true freedom lovers in the world will applaud that, whether Iranian, American, Canadians, French, whatever. And the ones who don't applaud it, tough. I really don't care.
I cannot improve that answer except to say one thing. Remember that this is all to be done properly, it is done with a full announcement to the world that we're doing it. You make an open announcement to the world. That's what it means to be self-assured and to know what you're doing. You make the announcement, this is the goal, the government of Iran must go. This is the ultimatum time limit or we'll do it. You don't do it behind the scenes, you don't pussyfoot around with it. You make the open announcement and you do it. And as far as the cheering on the bombers to bomb us, I have a friend 70 years old who was in Belgium when the American bombers were bombing to get the Nazis out, and he remembered his family cheering as the bombers came. This is fact that people did this. And I also have on tapes that I'm selling from the Ayn Rand bookstore, when I gave an expanded version of this lecture in a tape course last year, a man who was in his 70s who was German and was in a German village that was flattened by bombers. And he, at the question period, introduced a comment that is on the course that said he thought there was a moral reexamination in Germany of who they were and what they were as a result of this bombing. He said that before the bombing happened, he remembered as a little boy that stormtroopers being in a pub, you know, but drinking in a gin mill somewhere, and they were depressed because the war was going badly in the East. And he said his mother said, "Do you think maybe that the Führer will will surrender?" And their back sticking, then he said, "The Führer would never be such a swine." And they walked out all enlivened to go back to the battle. That had to be beaten. That had to be beaten. And when it was beaten, then they were discredited, they were gone, and then the country could be rebuilt. Not only rebuilt physically, but rebuilt in terms of its ideas.
This will be the last question.
Dr. Lewis, I'm curious to know what your predictions are, given that your plan of attack is not going to be implemented. Do you have dire predictions? Are we headed towards an Orwellian police state after a probable another dynamic attack, terrorist attack?
I don't have any predictions beyond it's not a prediction. I only just have one concern right now because it's such a strong concern that it swamps everything else, and that is if the Bush administration dawdles enough until Iran gets nuclear bombs. I want to add something about nuclear weapons. To my knowledge, no nuclear weapon has ever failed to work the first time it's tried. When America tried its bombs the first time, they worked. Now, it's hard to say that in the Soviet Union because they're secretive. But as far as we know, every time they tried a bomb, it worked. The technology is tried and proven today. Think of the implications of that. The Iranians do not have to set off a bomb and then start making ultimatums or demonstrations to the world. They can build the bomb, then they can put it on a tractor trailer, and they can move it somewhere and set it off. And they've got a perfect delivery system to do it, which is any one of these suicide bombers, any one of whom would like nothing better than to go up in that mushroom cloud. That threat to us is so large, so immediate. They're being built now. It's so large and so immediate that I can't think of anything else. And even if George Bush is in the back of his mind that he's not going to let this happen in Iran, how is he playing dice with our lives, basing it on intelligence? The same intelligence that told us that there were bombs in Iraq are now telling us that they're not in Iran. How can he play dice with the American people and let this go on? The threat is so big and so huge that it swamps everything else.
Thank you.
I'll skip predictions.
Skip predictions. Oh, no predictions.
Thank you.